Okay, would everyone please turn off cell phones and electronic devices and rise for a moment of silence and the pledge of the flag. But please remember Congressman, former Congressman Ben Gilman, who meant so much to our county. Okay, first up, we'd like to do roll call. I'm sorry. That's the first thing.
Bunsik?
Here.
Turnbull?
Here.
Amo?
Here.
Anagnostakis?
Present.
Benton?
Here.
Berkman?
Here.
Benelli? Cantorino?
Here.
Cheney?
Here.
Dillard?
Here.
DeSalvo?
Present.
Ekis?
Here.
Fagione? Hines?
Here.
Chemnitz?
Here.
Kulasek?
Here.
Paduk?
Here.
Ruskevich,
here.
Sullivan,
here.
Vero,
here.
Brescia,
here.
19 present, 2 absent.
Okay, we've got 3 presentations, I believe. First up, I'd like to invite the former county exec, Lou Heinbach, current county exec, Steve Newhouse, and former county legislative chairman, Alan Seidman. And is Maureen Hallahan here? Or Jim Smith? But Maureen was going to make it. Right up here.
Good morning, everybody. This started out, we got a phone call from Jimmy Smith. This is his brainchild. And he wanted to honor the former county executive, Lou Heinbach, with what used to be called Neelytown Road, was called the Road to Nowhere, rumored. But this was his forethought many years ago when I was probably going, I probably shouldn't say it because there's too many young kids here, but I was going through puberty when this was conceived. And the road ended up being a catalyst for economic development in Orange County. And I'm happy to say not only thank you to you, Lou, because I worked in the private sector there for a good part of my life before I got into politics in one of those businesses that is still thriving there on Neelytown Road today. And I'll let everybody do the remarks and then we'll show the sign. You can't keep this one, Lou. This is the one actually going up on the road. So Jimmy Smith from Advanced Testing, a big economic development leader in Orange County community, came up with this brainchild. We should honor Lou on this because it's been so successful. It's a model for other communities to create and designate one area for economic development. And it's a beautiful, thriving place today. We see many businesses there now. McKesson under construction. Pharmacanis just opened their doors earlier this spring. And many more continuing to grow there. So this is our tribute to you, Lou. And we have another economic development leader and former colleague. Were you in with him when he was county executive? Okay, well, you looked it in the pictures. So Alan Simon, a former chairman, he had a beard back then.
Actually, I was gonna comment that Lou was such a visionary, he was smart enough to get out the year I came in. But Lou is very modest, does not like public accolades. But he is truly a visionary. He wasn't just a government leader. He saw the future. He helped drive the future of this county, a true leader of this county. And it was an honor to be part of this. And I'd like to thank the legislature for seeing this through. And just wish everybody a happy holiday season and happy 2017.
Thank you, Alan. I told Lou that he had to be here today, and you don't tell Lou anything, you know, but he had a bank meeting, and that's just what kind of guy he is. He's always follows through on his commitments, and there, he has many of them, believe me. County 99 has meant so much to the town of Montgomery, and now the town of Hamptonburg, Matt, with Pharmacanis and McKesson and Carlisle. I'm not sure if it's in Montgomery or Hamptonburg, but it's meant so much to the whole county. Thousands and thousands of construction jobs on that corridor, and not to mention permanent jobs that are there today. My family had a retail business there for 5 years, and that corridor might not have been good to retail, but it's certainly been good to distribution and pharmaceutical companies. So we can't thank you enough for your foresight, your brainchild of bringing County 9 alive and making it a reality, and Carl Hellstrom following through on your plan. It's been magnificent for all of us, and we can't thank you enough, and this is just apropos and deserving. So say a few words.
Thank you very much, Mr. Executive, Mr. Chairman, and Chairman Seidman, honorable members of the legislature. Thank you very much for bestowing this honor on me. I'm usually a guy that likes to be in control and know what's going on. And I'll tell you, I was totally blindsided when this happened at the partnership dinner. He could have knocked me over with a feather, so I'm deeply humbled by the honor you're bestowing on me, and I thank you very much, and I'm not one for you. My rules usually are to stand on one leg when you're talking, and when you're done standing on one leg, you're finished, and at my advanced age, I no longer need to do that, but I know when I'm done. So thank you again, and happy holiday season to all of you. I really appreciate this very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Lou. And Maureen, did you want to just say a few words? I know you were very involved with this, and Antoinette, I thank you too for following through, and Chris Bybrock from the county, because it was a lot of work, but say just a few words.
Thank you. Thank you for doing this. Lou has always been a mentor and a friend to all of us, a very honorable county executive, three-term, and just a great guy and so deserving. So thank you for all you did, Steve, to help this happen. Thank you for your understanding that this had to be announced kind of quietly. Steve Newhouse, thank you also, and Alan, you're always there for us. Thank you.
Thanks again. Steve, you want to get a picture?
So here we go, Lou. This is the official one that's going up. You have the one you can hang up on your wall as well.
This will mess up the Google one.
It probably could. I've seen those signs. Don't use your Google for this. Steve, get in.
Did you buy 11 votes for this? Or?
I think we have 11 votes. I think we're safe.
Cool. Right? You can't keep this hard.
Okay, our next presentation is Tobacco 21, and who's leading that off? Dr. Avila has a presentation, and then young Eli Avila is going to speak for 3 minutes afterwards, I believe, right? And did everybody get a chance to look at the artwork? You're going to explain that, right, Doctor?
I will.
Beautiful artwork in the back.
Good morning. Thank you for having us here. I just wanted to share that Tobacco 21 is something that is very progressive, and I think it's really going to help the health of our nation as more states and more cities take the lead, and I'm glad that Orange County is considering being part of that leadership. In the back, you're going to see artwork, though, which is through BOCES. We've had 16 years of artwork where there's an anti-smoking campaign. This is just exquisite work. You would never think that children are doing this artwork. And I was thinking about this, that, you know what? I happen to know Tom Frieden, and I the head director of the CDC, and once we get the clearances, I'm going to send this artwork to him, because I think that he's very much involved in, as many of you have seen the TV commercials regarding anti-smoking, he's very much involved in, he's gotten a lot of flack from Congress regarding that, but the president, he was sharing with me, the president has been very good to him about it, to continue with the commercials on TV. But this is our youth, Orange County youth, involved in public health education. And it doesn't get better than that. And I'm going to be sending this artwork to him. The CV incorporates it at a national level with the artwork in the student's name to be used in anti-smoking campaigns. So that's something that's coming out of Orange County. I'm very proud of that. Now, that being said, my son did an internship with Reality and got to spend time with Reality Check, and I'll let him talk about that. Reality Check had asked him to present before the legislature. He's also going to be presenting before in February before Albany, when Reality Check meets in Albany with the entire legislature up in Albany. So he has a little something that he's prepared. He's going to read out loud, which will directly address the legislation, the proposed legislation that all of you will be voting on. Thank you.
I had the honor last month of my co-conspirators in the back, she's smiling, and you know, that undercover boss, we actually went undercover to buy cigarettes in some different establishments in Orange County. We had a young girl that was under the age, and she with us? No, or she's not with us today, right? She's not in here, okay, yeah, because I would have called her out. So we would walk in and pose as a couple buying like lunch or something, and this young lady would go in and try to buy cigarettes. Underage, and I went off script a lot, because as soon as, if they did the right thing, the shop owner, and they carded the girl and she left, a minute or two later, we'd buy something like water or candy, and I'd say, I just want to thank you, and they're like, why? I said, because you just passed the test. were checking cigarettes, you know, underage purchasing. And one quick thing I was joking about with John Vero and Jimmy DeSalvo, before I went into the Navy, I did 4 years with the Army and as a enlisted guy, and somebody posted a picture, I didn't share it to my Facebook page, I've been away for a couple of days, of me 15, 20 years ago in an enlisted Army uniform with a cigarette hanging out of my mouth. And it was the dumbest, and Wayne Booth just walked in, the deputy county executive, it was the dumbest thing I've ever did in my life to smoke, start smoking when I was younger. And we're going to address that later on with other legislation. But I'll tell you the best way to quit. I went on my first date with my wife. And the first date's when you get to feel each other out. You get to know each other, what you like, what you don't like. And my wife said, I will tell you one thing off the bat. I despise smoking. And a month or two later, we started dating. You know, we were dating. We got serious. And my friend said, I don't know how you got Steve to quit smoking. She goes, I didn't even know he was a smoker. And I literally stopped from that day, and I haven't had one since. And we've been married now 10 years, so it's 11 years. And it is great that we see these young members of our community looking at this and being inspiring to their peers to stop smoking, don't get into smoking. It's just probably the worst thing you could do for your body. So I applaud you all. I think you did a wonderful job up there, and I thank you for your efforts. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your efforts. Eli is going to come up and say a few words. And do all the students that are here for Tobacco 21 want to stand up? There are a few here, right?
Actually, they can
both come up. Yeah, why don't you guys come on up? Your moment of fame up here. Thank you. Where's Eli? Eli's going to speak first, and then you. I see some other scripts. You're going to read too? Yes?
Whoever wants to read can definitely work. I'm going to say a few words. Let's watch. It's your house. Everybody.
Chairman Brescia and esteemed members of the Orange County Legislature, I want to thank you for allowing me to address your legislative body. My name is Eli N. Avila II. This past summer, I served as a student intern in the Orange County Youth Bureau program. During that time, I was selected to be the only student to represent Orange County during the Reality Check 2016 Youth Summit, held for 3 days at Cazenovia College. The New York State Department of Health Bureau of Tobacco Control funds Reality Check to increase support for New York State's tobacco-free norm through the youth action and community engagement. Efforts are evidence-based, policy-driven, and cost-effective approaches that decrease youth tobacco use, protect youth from exposure to tobacco marketing and imagery, and eliminate exposure to secondhand smoke. I am before you today to encourage the Orange County Legislature to pass proposed local law, introductory number 19 of 2016, entitled A Local Law to Raise the Legal Age for Purchasing of Tobacco Products in Orange County, New York, to 21. In doing so, you'll be joining the states of Hawaii and California, the cities of Boston, Chicago, Kansas City, Cleveland, San Francisco, and New York City, and the New York State counties of Suffolk, Cattaraugus, Schenectady, Portland, Albany, and Chautauqua, who have made this preventive effort to reduce the terrible toll of smoking and tobacco use. Approximately 96% of smokers begin before age 21, with most beginning before age 16. Studies show that Tobacco 21 delays smoking initiation. Evidence shows that the younger the age of initiation, the greater the risk of nicotine addiction. It is an established medical fact that the brain continues to develop until approximately age 25, particularly in ways that affect impulsivity, addiction, and decision-making. Therefore, delaying smoking initiation reduces the likelihood of ever starting. Tobacco industry survival depends on youth and use and addiction. When someone is addicted, they are no longer free, but instead they are enslaved. Without tobacco policy intervention, the industry will continue to successfully entice youth to use their products. Furthermore, African Americans, non-Hispanic multiple race individuals, the mentally ill, LGBTQ individuals, and individuals of low socioeconomic status or lower education smoke at higher rates compared to the general population. These are marginalized and insular groups that need protection to avoid a reoccurring and generational curse of increased morbidity and early mortality. We can make a significant impact with the passage of this local law. Despite declines in youth smoking rates, 7.3% of New York high school students and 1.2% of New York middle school students reported smoking cigarettes in 2014. Without sustained action, nearly 874,000 New York lives, youth alive in 2014 are projected to become smokers, and an estimate of 280,000 of them will die prematurely. Orange County is poised today to lessen this societal tragedy. Hence, I simply urge you to pass this life-saving law and allow our youth to live free and healthy lives. Again, I thank you for this opportunity to address you. Have a good day.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I know some of you have some things to read. I see some scripts in your hands.
No?
Yep, come on up. Don't be shy.
I'm Tori Meinson, and I'm from the Orange County Reality Check. And we just wanted you guys to know that the Tobacco 21 is a good thing to have because people who smoke can die and stuff. And if we get this law, 2% will plummet, like they'll stop smoking. And 73,000 New York State high school students currently smoke.
10,600 youth under 18 become new daily smokers each year.
Smoking affects people's lives every day. Like, people die from it or people can get really sick. And if we raise the law that prevents health risk, and it'll be harder for the youth to get hold of these addictions. But thank you for letting us talk, and have a good day.
Thank you again for coming in. Is there anybody else that wants to say anything? Thank you for coming in and taking time out of your busy schedules. We really appreciate it, and we're going to act on this legislation soon.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Anything else, Shane?
No, that's it.
Any speakers signed up? Agenda. Legislator Cantorino wanted to say a couple words.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will be brief. First off, I would like to thank Gene, Kelly, Carrie Ann, and Doreen for all the help that they have given me during my time in office. And I would also like to thank Antoinette for always going above and beyond to provide an in-depth answer on any legal and procedural questions that I have asked. But I really want to tell my legislative colleagues that it has been truly an honor and a privilege to serve with you in this legislature. And I want to assure all our county residents that Orange County is in good hands. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Bill. Unfortunately, Legislator Faggione couldn't be here today. A dear friend of his, Walter, I forgot Walter's last name.
Hughes.
Hughes his funeral services this morning. So Melissa, you wanted to say a couple words on that?
Yes, actually I'll give this to Gene because I think he wanted this submitted in the public record. It was a little long to read today, and I think a lot of what he sent as a statement today is really something he should say himself about Walter at another meeting. But if I could just quickly read a portion of Tom's statement for today. As elected legislator for the 13th district, it's my duty to represent my neighbors and community here in county government. I take this responsibility seriously with much respect and honor. It is with respect that I am unable to be here today. On Monday, a dear friend and Port Jervis resident, Walter E. Hughes, passed away. Walter was an honorable World War II veteran, a member of our country's greatest generation. He served his country with distinction as a member of the 82nd Airborne Division, taking part in some of the fiercest fighting during the war. He and I became good friends, a bond I will never forget. This week, we say goodbye to Walter and lay him to eternal rest next to his wife, Mary. Airborne all the way, Walter. It is respect that I am unable to be here today. Tom Fagione, legislator. And thank you, Mr. Chairman, for letting me read that. And Gene, I'm just gonna give this to you if you don't mind. And I just wanted to say to you, Phil, thank you very much for your service in working with us. It was great working with you as well. Wanna start the agenda?
Yeah, you ready?
Okay, yes. I move to vote collectively on item numbers 1 through 27, which are the tax resolutions.
Second. Okay, that will be done. Are there any referrals, consents, or withdrawals? Number 42 is a withdrawal from the law department, correct? Okay, so that will be off the agenda, number 42. Okay, numbers 1 through 27 and 28 through 61 will be voted on collectively. And no one has signed up for public participation at the beginning. Okay, let's go through numbers 1 through 27, right? Okay, 1 through 27, we don't need to read it. Okay, so we're ready to go right for the vote on the 1 through 27, right? Okay, second, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekus, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduke, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham, 19 ayes.
Okay, now numbers 28 through 61. Oh, 28 individuals, I'm sorry. I screwed up my script again, I'm sorry. I wanted to get to lunch. All right, 28, I'm sorry. Thought it was more tax resolutions.
Legislator Benton, resolution accepting and confirming the report of the clerk of the legislature of the apportionment of the county budget as adopted for the ensuing year.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekus? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduke? Ruskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresham, 19 ayes.
Okay, 29, receive and file, number 29.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the report of the clerk of the legislature of the apportionment of the town budgets and levying upon the respective towns for town purposes pursuant to Article 8 of the town law and upon the respective districts thereof for district purposes pursuant to several provisions of the town law.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull,
yes.
Amo,
yes.
Anagnostakis, Benton, Berkman, Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekus, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduke, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham, 19 ayes.
Okay, 830, receive and file, number 30.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the summaries of taxes and special assessments to be levied in the several towns, districts, and cities, and directing the extension of said taxes on the assessment rolls pursuant to section 900 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekus? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduke? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Gresham. 19 ayes.
Okay, number 31.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the completed tax rolls of the several towns and cities and directing the execution and delivery of warrants for the collection of the taxes extended thereon pursuant to section 904 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonnison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amel?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ekis? Hines? Hemnitz? Horsack? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 19 ayes.
Okay, number 32.
Legislators Bonnison and Hemnitz, resolution apportioning and levying expenses against certain cities and towns in the County of Orange to pay a portion of the election expenses incurred by the County of Orange for the year 2016 for the primary and general elections held during said year.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonnison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amel?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? I'm sorry. Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo?
No.
Ekis? Fagion? Sorry. Hines?
No.
Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Gresham? 17 ayes, 2 noes.
Okay, number 33.
Legislators DeSavo, Chemnitz, and Benelli. Resolution pursuant to local law number 5 of 2015, ethics and disclosure law, section 8, paragraph A, amending appendix A, list of positions of certain county officials and local political officials required to file a financial disclosure form by deleting the current list and adopting an amended list in its place.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonnison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amel?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Gresham? 19 ayes.
Okay, A34, receive and file, number 34.
Legislators Anagnestakis, Riskevich, DeSalvo, and Bonnison. Local law introductory number 19 of 2016, a local law to raise the legal age for purchase of tobacco products in Orange County, New York to 21.
Second.
Discussion? Yes.
I'd like to be added.
Harry added. All Dems added. Bill? John? Mike Anagnestakis? You want to speak? Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I asked my colleague, Mr. DeSalvo, who brought this law forward, if he wanted to go first, and he said no, he didn't. So I'll take the lead on this. I was very happy to have him come and bring this law before the Health and Mental Health Committee. I'd been talking to Dr. Avila for months ahead of time, so I knew the importance of this law, and I think it's very well written. For anyone that questions whether this will have any effect or not, all they need to do is take a look at a report, a study done by the CDC, the Centers for Disease Control. I don't have my notes in front of me, but I kind of remember them. They did this study and they said if this kind of a law was implemented across the whole United States of America, you would have 225,000 less deaths every single year going forward. And it would account for savings of upwards of $10 billion in the healthcare system. And that's dramatic. Those are dramatic numbers. And if you prorate them out based on the population of Orange County, where we will have this law in effect, that means a couple of hundred deaths less every year. It's a couple of hundred lives saved and tens of millions of dollars saved in health care costs. Dramatic results. And again, if you have any doubt what side you're on when you're voting for this kind of a law, take a look and an internal document that Philip Morris put out in 1993. 1993, Philip Morris, the largest tobacco company in the world, told its executives in an internal study, if counties and states raise the law to 21 for smoking, it will, quote, gut our key young adult market in the United States of America. That's all you need to know. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, Matt?
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. So I've been candid about some of my struggles with addiction, and this was the first addiction that I dealt with in my life and at a very young age. I don't know exactly what age I started smoking, but it was before we moved from Brooklyn in 1959. So I had to be 10, maybe 11 years old. It wasn't until fairly recently that I realized that this addiction, for some time I considered it a minor addiction, was really set me up for future addictions. I love the comments of Mr. Avila, they're spot on. You know, I guess all of us got the letters from NIAC, which is a convenience store group. You know, I always read these kind of letters. I want to hear the other side's opinion. But in this instance, I took the letter and I ripped it up, threw it right in the garbage, because any step we can take in this direction is a good one. This is a horrible addiction. I think it hurts millions of people. The comments were just really great that the tobacco companies continue to thrive off this addiction. It's just very disturbing, and I'm glad that we're doing this today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
It was a long time ago when I was in college. I went to Queens College for my bachelor's. And one thing that impressed me at the time, because I came from a household where my mother had smoked, my father didn't. My mother smoked Pall Mall cigarettes and lit one as the other was coming to an end. I have not smoked. So I appeared as a freshman at the campus, and one of the first things that happened along with orientation was that a van pulled up, and it was Cool Cigarettes, king size, with a filter tip. And they were giving out little packs of cigarettes, only three cigarettes, to everyone on campus. Now, I happened to be 16 when I got into college. But if you figure out what college age is, they were, if you will, infecting the very group that we are now looking at to try to be saving. So I'm certainly voting for this.
Thank you. Kevin?
Yes, thank you. I see Joanne Parker in the audience from the American Heart Association. I appreciate you being here. I thank Mr. DeSalvo for bringing this forward. It's a long time coming. I have a 21-year-old son who smokes, and he told me, make sure you pass this law. He knew that he got poked early, and he's fighting. So it's very important. I thank you all for doing this.
Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you very much. I first just wanted to thank all the young people who are here today. As I think you said Tobacco 21, and there was a mention of Reality Check. Being a high school teacher myself, I see sometimes, you know, teenagers make a lot of great decisions, but also at the age that they make a lot of poor decisions as well. And I think there's a lot of factors out there, whether it's in the media, on TV, in the movies, that promote smoking because it's cool. We know today that smoking is not cool, and we know more than generations before us, my parents' generation, of course, my grandparents' generation, we know a lot more of the dangers of smoking. And my vote today, yes, is a public health vote, just, you know, trying to prevent younger people from starting earlier, and hopefully by doing that, not starting at all in their lives. And I just also wanted to thank Jim DeSalvo for bringing this forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Barry, and then Jeff.
Thank you. Let me begin by thanking my colleague, Legislator DeSalvo, for having the vision and persistence to bring this legislation forward to the floor of this legislature with the unanimous support of two committees. I also want to thank the County Health Department for their support and their ongoing efforts to address the health impacts of tobacco use. The local law will add Orange County to a growing list of counties in New York who have enacted a Tobacco 21 law. Hopefully others will follow, and in doing so, send a strong message to Albany, and we will see a statewide law adopted by the legislature and signed by the governor. In addition to the obvious benefit of reducing the number of individuals who become addicted to tobacco products, and thus reducing the price we all pay to fight the associated diseases, the most important impact of this law for me is that it changes the smoking dynamic of our high school-aged youth. No longer will an 18-year-old still in high school be able to purchase tobacco products on their own and give or sell them to a 15, 16, or 17-year-old. I want to thank the high school students here today for being in support of this legislation. For those who might suggest that this law is an infringement on personal rights, I would like to relate a conversation I had on this issue with a person I would describe as being very conservative. His position was that he was normally not in favor of government getting involved in personal choice. In this case, he saw it differently, because the actions of those who chose to smoke create an economic burden for the rest of us as taxpayers and as insurance ratepayers. He was fully supportive. These are the reasons I am in full support of this local law. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I support this resolution and for the public health concerns, as others have stated, but I would prefer not to be the sponsor while I do support it.
Steve. Sorry. Yes, Chris. That's all right. I'm hidden back here. I want to thank Legislator Jim DeSalvo for bringing this forward also. I certainly think that we're going to have a very successful vote on this law. But when I first joined the legislature, I worked with Reality Check, who was in downtown city of Newburgh and all. And so I want to put a challenge out there, since we have Reality Check folks sitting in the audience. And that is that what's next? What's next is advertisement. We have to work to get the advertisement away from the front doors, away from the height of children, and move it back. Some of the municipalities, for instance, the city of Newburgh has established its own law for issuing licenses to sell tobacco, but I think across this county, we need to be proactive and work to create a law, work with us, Reality Check, to create a law to ban this advertising, which is nothing more than trying to attract young folks to smoke. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Suzanne.
I have a message for the students, the young adults who are here this evening. On January 5th will mark 1 year that I have not smoked. And I've smoked all my life. And there was one reason why I quit. And that is because my children have been bugging me every single day since they were able to quit smoking. So my message to you is, keep doing what you're doing. You're doing a great job. Don't give up. Thank you.
Okay, before I recognize Legislator DeSalvo, I just wanted to say a couple things. And I was signing tax warrants up here. I wasn't signing Christmas cards. And I was paying attention to what everybody had to say. You know, when Legislator DeSalvo brought this forth to me, I told him that I was inclined not to vote for it. Many years ago, it came before one of the previous legislatures that to ban smoking in restaurants and taverns and such establishments. And there were 6 legislators out of 21 that voted against that. And myself, Michael Lamo, and Lee Benton were 3 of them. I can't remember the other 3, Alan. Maybe you can. I don't know. But because I certainly don't miss smoking in restaurants and taverns, but I just thought it was a matter of rights and rights for people not to go in those establishments. But eventually the state soon thereafter passed legislation banning smoking in restaurants and taverns. And I was inclined to also, with the argument that 18-year-olds can go fight in the armed services and they can vote, and yet we're banning them from smoking. But we're really not banning them from smoking, in a sense. We're just banning the sale to anyone under 21. So I was really sold at the Health and Mental Health Committee meeting chaired by Legislator Nagnostakis when Dr. Avila and Jim DeSalvo presented some of those stats. And I have 2 young boys, and all the bad things that happened from smoking were shown, or many of them, at that meeting, and I was really sold, so I'm going to vote for this. And Legislator DeSalvo, you want to finish it up?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Boy, if I had a dollar for every time I heard my name today, I'd be able to buy lunch later. Thanks. I appreciate everybody's help and support. Yeah, right. I just want to thank the subcommittees that I went through, and the support we got through that was unanimous. I want to thank Ms. Reed for helping with the law, and I want to thank her for her knowledge, and we went through a little fix last month.
We sent it back to committee, but it was unanimous. You know, government sometimes gets a little sticky, and but in this case, it worked quite nicely. And, you know, we took some constructive criticism from those folks who aren't in favor of the law, and they found that little flaw that we had in it, and we fixed it. And, you know, we went back. But the important thing that that all comes from today is the fact that these young folks came to speak about it. And, you know, if we can save a few lives with this legislation, then it's worth it. You know, I live right outside of West Point military base. And the Army is looking in different ways on making their soldiers healthier. So that argument to me seems real null. You know, it's a good thing. I'm glad Orange County's moving forward with it. I'm sure that the county executive will support it, or his wife will give him a hard time. Again, I want to thank everybody and look forward to voting on this.
Okay, roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Cantorino?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Chemnitz? Kulisek?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Ruskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan? Vero?
Yes.
Gresha? 19 ayes.
Okay, number 35.
Legislators Bonacic, Sullivan, Amo, resolution authorizing the Orange County Executive on behalf of the Orange County Department of Social Services to enter into an intermunicipal agreement between the County of Orange and the Village of Goshen pursuant to General Municipal Law Section 1190.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresha, 19 ayes.
Okay. Yep, we were gonna excuse you, but you're already taking a beeline, so that's okay. I'd like to recognize three individuals in the audience, too. Legislator-elect Jim O'Donnell is in the back row. Former county legislative clerk, Gail Cecina, and who did I miss? Al Buckby just strolled in. Good to see you, Al. Okay. Number 30. Oh, outside. We recognized him earlier, you know. Taught me a lot over the years, that guy. 36.
Legislator Sullivan and Cantorino. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Health to appropriate second year budget period funds from the New York State Department of Health pursuant to Section 99-H of General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresha? 21 ayes. I'm sorry, 19 ayes.
Okay, number 37.
Legislator Sullivan, Cantorino. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Health to accept and appropriate supplemental grant funds from the New York State Department of Health pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll. You want to be added, Jim? Jim Kulisek. Okay. Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Gresha? 19 ayes.
And number 38.
Legislators Sullivan and Cantorino. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Health to accept and appropriate funding from the New York State Division of Criminal Justice Services pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Question? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresha, 19 ayes.
Okay, number 39.
Legislators Sullivan, Cantorino, Benton, and Anagnostakis. Resolution authorizing the Orange County Executive on behalf of the Orange County Department of Residential Health Care Services to accept an authorized intergovernmental transfer payment and to decrease appropriated 2016 county taxation.
Second.
Discussion. Myrna, you want to be added?
Okay.
Roll call.
Vlasic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 19 ayes.
Okay, number 40, bond resolution requiring 2/3 vote.
Legislator Sullivan, Cantorino, Benton, Kulisek. Bond resolution dated December 22nd, 2016. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the planning and construction of improvements to the sewer water treatment plant at the Valley View Center, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $135,000, appropriating said amount therefore and authorizing the issuance of $135,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 19 ayes.
Okay, number 41, Legislator Hines brought to Ways and Means because it was announced after the rules meeting, so number 41.
Legislators Benton, Benelli, Hines. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature opposing the proposed plan of the Board of Trustees for St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital to close its emergency department at the Cornwall campus.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes.
All Democrats want to be on?
No.
Okay. All Democrats? All Republicans? Okay. Michael or no? Okay. Discussion, Kevin? I'm sorry.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, we're here talking about the Cornwall Hospital emergency room closing. The late, great Yogi Berra would say it's deja vu all over again, and I hope he's right in this case, because maybe they'll change their mind again. When the hospital announced for the second time that they were going to close the emergency room, they had public input at Pier 9. They invited elected officials to go to the Cornwall Hospital campus and meet with the chairman of the board and the CEO. And on that day, I asked the chairman of the board, Joan Cusack McGurk, how many people will die as a result of the Orange County emergency room closing? And she said to me very cavalierly, I don't have a crystal ball. She didn't say nobody, that was her answer. So we know it'll affect lives. And from our perspective in Orange County, that leaves us Orange Regional Medical Center and St. Luke's in Newburgh. If those two hospitals are on divert or overcrowded, you're going to Good Samaritan or Vassar, or maybe you can catch a $15,000 helicopter ride to Westchester. The only ones that I've spoken to that are in favor of this are the funeral homes and the Social Security Administration. I think they speak for themselves. This is a life safety hazard for all of Eastern Orange County. I met a man Wednesday night, not this Wednesday, but last Wednesday, and he said, you're exactly right fighting this hospital closing. My mother was transferred from a nursing home to St. Luke's Hospital, and there were so many people in the emergency room, and she needed an ICU bed. And they said, there's no ICU beds available. So all the patients that should have been in ICU are housed in the St. Luke's campus of Newburgh in the emergency room, and they use it as an ICU because they don't have enough beds up there. So that causes a massive overcrowding in the emergency room. So your typical emergency room patients are in the hallway with no dignity and lack of care. Everybody here knows that the Cornwall Emergency Room is an MS-1 facility, and it still is our MS-1 facility to this day, although we're looking to transfer it to Orange Regional because we don't trust the administration at the Cornwall Hospital. This is a life safety decision, and in the letter that is attached to the resolution, if you look at the announcement that they made, the announcement is ridiculously deceiving. St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital announces expansion of programs at its Cornwall campus. Emergency services consolidated to right-sized care delivery. So what does that mean? Your emergency room is closing and everything else is fluff. If you look at the top of the letter, it says St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital, with you for life. Well, that's if you're still alive, but they may be speeding up the deaths of the citizens, as basically admitted by their CEO. So this is a health, safety, life safety matter for all of Eastern Orange County, because if you live in Newburgh and St. Luke's is overcrowded, guess what? You're getting a hall bed if you're lucky. The press release put out by the Cornwall Hospital said that they have about 48 patients a day at the Cornwall ER. Nobody that I've spoken to in the healthcare profession thinks that the St. Luke's Newburgh campus can handle an additional 48 patients a day while they already have people laying in the hallway. And when they go to divert, your next option is either Orange Regional in Middletown or Vassar, which is now, I guess, part of Westchester Medical Center in Poughkeepsie. Lives matter, and God forbid the people from Highland Falls. All these issues we talked about last time. They told us last time, I believe it was an additional 5.5 miles in 12 minutes if you were in Highland Falls and you had to pass the Cornwall Emergency Room. Well, everybody who's in emergency services knows that the time matters, especially when you're having a heart attack. And the other call, I'll make it again. If they go through with this, please take the sign off the place that says hospital, because it will only be a glorified doctor's office. Anybody who's visiting from, whether it be Stewart Airport, Woodbury Commons, Storm King Art Center, is gonna drive past that facility, see a sign that says hospital. They have chest pains, they're gonna think, great, I got a fighting chance. They're gonna pull in, sorry, we're closed. The present plan calls from the parking ambulance there for 6 days. And after 6 days, if nobody shows up, which after they close, that's it, it's all over. So please support this. They've changed their mind twice already. Maybe, just maybe, they'll do it again if we get enough support. Thank you.
Okay, Legislator Amo, you want to say a few words?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm probably gonna be the only one who opposes this, and I'd only bring my healthcare experience to it and ask you to try to understand what the concept of health system is. We see at the bottom of the page, Montefiore Health System. Under the current Affordable Care Act, under the current DSRIP, which is the Medicaid downsizing approach, there are so many changes that are happening in delivery of our system. And if we don't understand that whole system, we're gonna make some mistakes in our decision. I totally understand the emotional concern of the people of the area. I totally understand the populist view. I've had to deal with that most of my career, dealing with people who say, well, this is the way you should practice medicine versus this way. I think the problem we realize as a system, that if you all remember systems theory, you know, take a balloon full of water, and if you push on one side, it comes out the other. Just you think that concept for a minute. You know, if you take and you force the hospital to include an emergency room in Cornwall, the dollars that they have to spend on that are gonna have to come out of something else. It's not an open system. It's a finite closed system. So, and it's getting tighter and tighter and tighter as Medicare and Medicaid and other insurance begin to tighten them out. So when they say, well, we're not getting the right approach here, we need to look at them and say, okay, we understand the system. How can we work with you to provide the best health care for the residents of Orange County? And how do we begin to say, let's negotiate it rather than draw a line in the sand and say, we're not going beyond this point? Let's start talking about the best way we can deliver services so people don't have to pull into a hospital sign and get a heart attack, have a heart attack. I totally agree with many of the points that Kevin said, but we need to understand the whole system. So I warn people to think that way. Thank you.
Okay, roll call. Legislator Sabe, you want to say quick?
Yeah, just real quick. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to echo the comments of Legislator Hines. For Highland Falls, Fort Montgomery, Town of Highlands area, you know, this definitely adds a huge length of time to get to the hospital, to get to the emergency room. And like I said in an interview on the radio, you know, ambulances have changed over the last 20 years. I understand that, and there's more technology. But the bottom line is that if you're coming from Fort Montgomery, New York, and you have to take a 20-minute drive to St. Luke's or 18-minute drive to St. Luke's, that's going to be the longest 18 minutes of your entire life. And that's the bottom line. Thank you.
Okay, roll call. Legislator Nagustakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, of course, I agree with everything that all three of my colleagues have said. But I've said this in committee, and I'll say it again here for the record, if nothing else. You know, elections matter, and who you put into office matters. And sometimes I hear some of the people that are the most vocal in support of keeping the emergency room open, people that are not sitting up here today, people that are in other elected offices that are higher than where we are. You know, the reason that the hospital is in the position that it is, Mr. Amo's correct, because the healthcare system has changed. The Affordable Care Act has gone into place, and it has caused financial trouble to some places, including the hospital. So you can't argue and scream and yell, I want to save that hospital, when you are in support of having the Affordable Care Act implemented in New York State. And then the hospital has just gotten a major grant that was approved up in Albany. Well, the grant was only given when the hospital was asked to come up with a cost-saving plan, put it in writing, and bring it up to Albany to get that grant approved. And they did. And part of that grant application was that we're going to close the emergency room. And Albany said yes, and we're going to give you this grant money in return. Yet some elected officials, not sitting here today, I'm going to emphasize, are making a big deal. We got this grant money. Well, you got the grant money, and in return, they're closing the emergency room. That was the deal in Albany. Can't have it both ways all the time.
Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Abel?
No.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines?
Yes.
Chemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 18 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, number 42 withdrawn. Number 43.
Legislators Benton, DeSalvo. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Planning to accept and appropriate funds as a subcontractor for the Orange County Department of Health pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Biro, Brescia. 19 ayes.
Number 44.
Legislators Benton and Berkman. Resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Finance for the County of Orange to make refunds or corrections of taxes in the amount of $2,500 or less.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amel,
yes.
Anagnostakis, Benton, Berkman, Cantorino, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Biro, Brescia. 19 ayes.
And 45.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2016 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to Section 556 of Real Property Tax Law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia. 19 ayes.
Number 46.
Legislator Benton, resolution pursuant to Real Property Tax Law Section 558, directing the cancellation of certain taxes which have been rendered unenforceable.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Biro? Brescia. 19 ayes.
47.
Legislators Benton and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the private sale and conveyance of certain county-owned lands acquired by reason of a failure to redeem said lands from a tax sale to Orange County pursuant to Section 10184 of the Real Property Tax Law and Orange County Amended Local Law Number 2 of 2010.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia. 19 ayes.
Number 48.
Legislators Benton and Benelli, bond resolution dated December 22, 2016, bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the replacement of flooring of the Goshen Public Works Garage, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $750,000, appropriating $300,000, therefore, in addition to the $450,000 previously appropriated, and authorizing the issuance of $300,000 bonds of the county to finance the balance of said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
No.
Benton? Berkman?
No.
Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Behines? Hemnitz? Pulisic? Padoo? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Bureau? Gresham? 17 ayes, 2 noes.
Okay, number 49.
Legislators Bureau, Benton, Turnbull. Resolution authorizing the Orange County Airport to transfer funds from the airport fund balance to three capital projects pursuant to Section 4.10 of the Orange County Charter.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
No.
Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo?
No.
Ekis? Hines? Hemnitz? Pulisic? Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham. 17 ayes, 2 noes.
Okay, number 50.
Legislator Gresham. Resolution dedicating the County Route 99 Neelytown Road from New York State Route 208 to County Route 416 in the town of Hamptonburg in honor of Louis Heimbach.
Second.
Discussion? All Dems, all Republicans, and Independents. Fantastic. Okay, roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman?
Yes.
Cantorino?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo? Ekis?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Hemnitz? Pulisic? Padoo?
Yes.
Ruskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan? Bureau?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
19 ayes.
Unanimous, Mr. Heimbach. Well deserved. Okay, number 51.
Legislators Ruskevich and Turnbull. Resolution authorizing the Orange County Executive on behalf of the Orange County Department of Public Works to submit a petition to the New York State Department of Transportation pursuant to Railroad Law Sections 210 and 90.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham. 19 ayes.
And number 52.
Legislators Benelli, Kulisek, Benton. Resolution approving the abandonment and transfer of maintenance of Mountainville Bridge and Taylor Road Bridge to the town of Cornwall.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Kevin.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to thank my predecessor, Mr. Seidman, who put this project together years ago. The county took ownership of that bridge for the sole purpose of obtaining federal and state monies to get that repaired, and now we're just completing the task that Alan started probably 12 years ago, believe it or not.
1904.
Yeah, okay. So I was right. Oh, 1904. All right. It looks great. We did a ribbon cutting ceremony. The people of the Mountainville Fire Company that are right there appreciate it. The Black Rock Fish and Game Club appreciates it, and everybody who uses that bridge. So thank you, Alan, and thank you for Chris Vibrock for getting this done.
Alan's a big bridge person. Was it Plum Point, the other one?
can you add my name, please?
Yes, certainly. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Padoo? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham. 19 ayes.
Okay, number 53.
Legislators Padoo and Kulisek. Resolution authorizing the county executive to sign an easement agreement and authorize the acquisition of a right-of-way and easement over, under, and upon a parcel of real property owned by the city of Middletown.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Jeff.
I think we're all ready to have this heritage trail finally move from Goshen to Middletown, through Middletown, and out to Howell. So we've been all dedicated and committed to this project for a very long time. That's why it's disconcerting to discover that we may have yet another delay, which would postpone clearing of the trail from the trees in order to protect wildlife, specifically a bat. Some folks say, let's send it back to Indiana, right? But what I urge all of us to do, all of us here, as well as the county executive, the mayor of Middletown, and other state officials, I hope that we could all contact our federal officials in order to ask them for their assistance in getting the log jam loosened from Fish and Wildlife. And I think that's the ball is in that court now, and I think we can persevere to encourage everyone to get on board and finally get this job finished.
Okay. Gary?
Yeah, I'd just like to make a clarification on the schedule. The schedule that was presented a number of months ago to Middletown by Commissioner Rose included that the project would be bid in July. So there really hasn't been any delay. There was not going to be the ability to take down any trees during this particular time, and that would be done at the beginning of the project in the fall.
Yeah, I'll reiterate just for a second that I think in the last year or so on this project, we've moved fairly quickly. We haven't delayed on our end, and you know, they're subject to the same regulations that all these other companies that come in with the Indiana bat, unfortunately. I understand your frustration with that, but that's what they all have to deal with. Did somebody else have their hand up over here? Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekus, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vera, Gresha. 19 ayes.
Okay, number 54.
Legislators Benelli and Turnbull, resolution authorizing the county executive on behalf of the Orange County Department of Parks, Recreation, and Conservation to enter into an agreement to maintain, repair, and energize the entire lighting system for the culvert within the geographical jurisdiction of the County of Orange, such highway identified as Route 208, State Highway 9057, in Village Town of Monroe, County of Orange.
Second.
Discussion. Murray, you want to be added? Okay, no, not a problem. Oh, you have a question. Okay, go ahead.
When this came before the caucus to look at it the other day, when I first read it, my initial response was, what? Simply because if you do this, I'm concerned about two things. And of course you have to do it because otherwise the bridge which exists. First of all, how is the traffic which comes from downtown Monroe and uses 17M over the 208 old bridge to get to Route 208 to get to Route 17 to go towards your greater municipal New York area, going to do that if they have a culvert? Well, the word culvert here isn't the water carrier, we found out. It's a cement kind of a structure, like an overpass or something like that. That was one of the questions. How is the traffic coming out of Monroe going to get to Route 17, regular Route 17. Also, how will the traffic come back? And the other question was, if you're going to have a culvert or a road which is going under the Heritage Trail, will there be a two-way traffic thing with two lanes? And will the lane which is going from 17M up to 208 have maybe a turnoff that could go to South Orange Family Y, which is something that may fit in with what we're looking at and originally getting a road, a private road, from 17M to go over the Heritage Trail directly into South Orange Family Y. So it's two questions. And in the middle of the night, I woke up and I texted Commissioner Weyerbrock and he answered this morning, but I was in the car. And then I spoke very briefly to our Antoinette. And if you could explain to me, because I know you had a conversation with him, with the closing of the traffic and with the with a necessity of trying to get a private road or a way to get from 17 into South Orange Family Y's parking area, what is happening?
Okay, so,
he's gonna ask for it.
Yeah.
this resolution is, the state is going to be doing the work on the road, and they'll provide for the detours, and we don't have that information yet, but they will have detours, and that road will be closed for the amount of time necessary to do the work. This agreement, this resolution is an agreement for us to take care of the lighting on this project. So at some time before the project is executed, we'll have the information on the detours.
Well, as I said, of course I'm worried about the light. This is important, but on lighting what?
They're lighting the tunnel. So the concrete tunnel that's going to be put in place is going to need lighting, and the county is going to be responsible for providing tamper-proof type lighting to go through that tunnel.
Okay, I was confused when they say culvert, and I hear you saying tunnel. To me, a tunnel goes...
It's a preformed concrete tunnel that's going to be put in place. I have to believe that will be in sections because it's going to be about 60 to 100 foot of tunnel, and it can't all be one because of the weight. So they'll be connecting these concrete tunnels. This is my guess, but we don't have this information yet. We'll have it soon enough, but until we have the plans and the detour plans, we're doing right now is spinning our wheels, speculating how it's going to be done. So my recommendation is to wait until we have more information, and our questions will be answered. If there's problems at that point, we can address them.
Thank you, Legislator Cheney.
Yeah, maybe I can add a little more illumination to the questions. As Legislator Turnbull said, this is a tunnel. It's about 75 feet long. And the purpose of replacing the bridge is because the bridge is deteriorated to a point where it can no longer sustain the traffic. And they're replacing it with a tunnel. It's called a culvert in some circumstances. Tunnel is probably a more accurate reflection. It's about 16 feet wide, I believe, and 18 feet tall. And the purpose of it being a tunnel and not just filling in that area is that it needs to carry the Heritage Trail under Route 208 so that there's no interaction between people using the Heritage Trail and traffic on Route 208. So our only obligation here and responsibility is for the illumination of that 75-foot tunnel, because granted, without the illumination, it would make a lot of people very uncomfortable trying to go that 75 feet with very little light to aid them and make them feel safe.
Okay. Yes, Legislator Ben.
Thank you. Yes, at the paperwork that was handed out at Physical Services, there is a nice two-page handout. There's a picture, an overview of aerial photography of this section. On page 2 of that paperwork, there's a little thing, a little actual cross-section drawing by an engineer that shows a very small little slab down at the bottom of it that says Heritage Trail, and it shows the arch of the concrete tube or tunnel or box culvert going over top of it. So you can always refer to that.
Okay. And this can always be discussed further in Physical Service and or with the County Exec's Office, Murray. You know, they can explain.
Yeah, so many of your questions. Murray, that's the schematic drawing.
Can we do roll call? Or you good, Murray, for now? I'm going to say roll call.
Onasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Biro? Russia, 19 ayes.
Okay, number 55 and 56, if nobody has a problem, we can do them together. Correct, Antoinette?
No.
Okay. No. You don't want to do them together?
Nope.
Okay, okay. Further discussion, but 55.
Legislators Fagione, Dillard. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature reappointing Edward A. Diana to the Orange County Industrial Development Agency pursuant to sections 856 and 912 of a general municipal law.
Second.
Discussion. Legislator Hines.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. 2 years ago, we voted on this very same individual. I voted no then, I'm going to vote no today. I think 2 years ago the vote was 18-3, and immediately upon the appointment, the individual decided to not show up to several meetings right off the bat, and I let my displeasure to our chairman be known that we appointed someone who is part-time living down south and not coming to the meetings, and I didn't think it was proper. So now we're looking at a 5-year appointment, and I see it as a problem. This individual has a campaign account with several hundred thousands of dollars in it, but I didn't check recently. I assume it's still there. And I don't think the IDA was created to be a political organization. If they wanted politicians making these decisions, we as a legislature would probably be making them. So I think that when the IDA was conceptualized, and I don't know when it started, but maybe Mr. Heinbeck does, it was made to not have politicians on it. Now we have Chairman Brescia on the committee as our representative, which makes sense because he can keep us advised as to what's going on there. But if you're going to make up a board of elected officials or people that are actually, I've actually heard rumors that the individual may run again at some point in time, and maybe even within that 5-year appointment, so that's a huge problem for me. I attended the Orange County Partnership event recently, and I was surprised, or I shouldn't have been surprised, I wasn't surprised, but I noticed there were so many talented people in that room. I think there was 650 people at the event. I said, wow, what a vast pool of experience of people that don't have this political tie that could do such a great job. And I just think it leaves the IDA open to criticism. They get criticized a lot for their decisions. I agree with most of their decisions. I disagreed with two or three over the years. But when you leave it open to criticism like this, it's just a bad idea. I really think it's a bad idea, and I hope my colleagues vote against this and that we get a new name with some new ideas. Thank you. And it's Christmas. I'm being very polite.
Maybe you'll see the three ghosts later. My legislator, Emo. Just kidding. Stop.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been, as not a member of either caucus, I've been sort of removed from a lot of the internal debate around this issue, although I hear it from other perspectives. And what I've noticed is that leading up to this vote, we've had a lot of debate and discussion about the right person to help us with the IDA. We've had a lot of criticism of the IDA. We're looking for that way to make it the best organization possible. Most of that debate, in my hearing of it, has been centered around the candidate and the qualifications of the person that will do the best job for Orange County residents and the county as a whole. Yet some, unfortunately, have been focused on the person being Eddie Diana, and we heard Mr. Hines' position on that as well. I certainly could argue the other way or either way, but the most important thing, regardless of how we think personally about the candidate, I think it's our role to think about qualifications, the resume, the ability, the experience that the person will bring to the county to help us move forward. I think that's the right way to go, not the latter way of looking at the person. And any of my colleagues who will think about voting based on the person, I ask themselves to rethink that a little bit and maybe go back to some of the training we've all had here on collaborative governing. I know you'll point your finger at me on that. And we read chapter one of Getting the Yes that says on issues, take the person out of the issue, debate the issue, and if it stands on merit, move forward. And I think that's really the question. We gotta take the person out of the issue. If the person doesn't have the qualifications, then a no vote is justified. But let's not talk about it in terms of the person as I'm hearing it. Again, one person's perspective. I'm a yes vote. Thank you.
Yeah, I just have to say that I respectfully disagree with Legislator Hines, and we've had this discussion, and I certainly understand why he stands where he does on the issue. There were differences in the past, and I ask some legislators to look beyond those differences. I mean, legislators didn't agree with the county exec. Many legislators on the county government center that is being built presently, or what was proposed to be built, or Valley View, or other matters. But the cornerstone of Ed Diana's administration was certainly economic development, and something he can hang his hat on. I mean, he's got a broad range of economic development expertise. He's out of the public sector now. He brings many qualifications. I mean, he was a businessman for decades.
I think he's still, is he working for the construction contractors now? He was for a while, though, for short term. You know, we certainly have to separate that from, I was upset when he missed the first two or three meetings when he took office 2 years ago, but he's since had great attendance, very involved with the IDA. I wasn't prepared to speak to this today because I thought we were going to withdraw it because we have two legislators not here today that were definitely going to vote for Edward's appointment. But, you know, we could certainly bring it back next month, but I think some legislators want to vote on it today. But I ask you to separate that from, you know, personal differences because he does have a great range in economic development. It's been his mantra, one of the most successful parts of his 12-year administration. Legislator elect O'Donnell was part of that for many of the 12 years, and he can tell you firsthand what they did to business in the Orange County, whether it's small business or large businesses coming in. I think he's got great expertise. And I thought it was going to be next month, so Chairman Armistead had sent us a letter, which he was going to overnight, which you'll probably get today, all legislators, endorsing fully Ed Diana's appointment, especially his involvement with the accelerator and other things of the IDA. So I encourage you to vote for his appointment today. Legislator Turnbull.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'm a no vote, and I happen to like Mr. Diana. I got to know him when he was the county executive. I'm sad that my caucus is split on this. I provided them with reasons, five reasons to vote against this. And it kind of addresses that thing about, you know, liking somebody, voting for somebody because you like them, or voting for somebody because they're qualified. In other words, it goes to principle before personality. Big fan of that myself. I remember when Mr. Diana called me one Saturday morning and he said, when referring to people in this business, we don't use the word liar. Apparently I was quoted in the press as calling somebody a liar, and he said, use the word inaccurate, not true, misleading, but you don't use the word liar. And I think that my problem with Mr. Diana is he's too willing to use misleading information. I remember when we were having the debate on the Orange County Government Center, he provided a spreadsheet that showed that it would be cheaper to knock down the Government Center and put up a new center than it would be to renovate it. And I was outraged by that, having had been a builder for 30 years. I knew that just wasn't true. I also take exception with his comment that by this time, this year, Valley View would be not $15 million, have a $15 million deficit, but a $30 million deficit. So I think his judgment is flawed, and I think somebody who has such flawed judgment should not be in this position. Thank you.
Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino?
Epstein.
Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekus? Hines?
No.
Eminence?
No.
Bulsek? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan?
No.
Bureau?
No.
Brescia? 13 ayes, 5 noes, 1 abstention.
Okay, number 56.
Legislators Fagione and Dillard. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature reappointing Edward A. Diana to the Orange County Funding Corporation, a local development corporation authorized pursuant to Section 1411 of a New York State not-for-profit corporation law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull? Amo?
Yes.
Turnbull, I'm sorry. Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekus? Hines?
No.
Eminence,
no.
Kulisek, Paduk, Riskevich? Sullivan?
No.
Vero?
No.
Gresham? 13 ayes, 5 noes, 1 abstention.
Okay, number 57.
Legislators Ickes and Fagione, resolution of the Orange County Legislature reappointing Robert J. Scrabby Sr. to the Orange County Industrial Development Agency pursuant to sections 856 and 912 of a general municipal law.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Paul wants to be added. Okay. Barry wants to be added as well. Roll call. John Bureau added. Okay. Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Padue?
No.
Riskevich? Sullivan?
No.
Vero? Gresham? 15 ayes, 3 noes, 1 abstention.
Okay, number 58.
Legislators Ickes and Fagione, resolution of the Orange County Legislature reappointing Robert J. Scrabby Sr. to the Orange County Funding Corporation, a local development corporation authorized pursuant to section 1411 of the New York State Non-For-Profit Corporation Law.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Padue,
no.
Riskevich, Sullivan,
no.
Vero, Gresham, 15 ayes, 3 noes, 1 abstention.
Okay, number 59.
Legislators Fagione, Benton, Kulisek, Riskevich. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to abolish executive secretary and administrative assistant and create senior secretary and administrative assistant at the Orange County Department of Parks, Recreation, and Conservation pursuant to section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull? Emo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Padue, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham, 19 ayes.
Okay, number 60.
Legislators Cantorino, Cheney, Benton, and Hines. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to create principal account clerk and abolish associate clerk one and associate clerk at the Orange County Department of Finance pursuant to section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, Padue, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham, 19 ayes.
Number 61.
Legislators Cheney, Cantorino, Bonacic, Berkman, Kulisek. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to create confidential secretary to the Board of Ethics part-time at the Orange County Board of Ethics pursuant to section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Cantorino? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? Padue? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham. 19 ayes, Mr. Chairman, and the desk is clear.
Okay, nobody signed up for public participation. I just want to acknowledge Lou Heinbach again. It was your idea to form the partnership too, I believe, was it not? And the IDA as well? No, yeah, you're not going to take the blame for the IDA. But, okay. I'd like to wish everyone a happy, healthy, prosperous holiday season, and hopefully we'll see most of you at Kelly Jean's. Yes, Jeff.
Thank you, Phil.
Yes, thank you, Phil. Appreciate your time in the legislature.
Thank you.